All right, well, good morning, and sorry about that little musical interlude. We're still getting used to the tech, but it is very exciting. But a warm welcome to all of you to St. John's this morning. And as always, we'll be going following the liturgy either on the screens, which are dotted around for you, or in the booklet. So I'm going to start with just a welcome for us this morning. So the grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Wonderful. And we'll be starting just with a short family song, because worship is a time where the whole body of Christ, young and old, can worship God together. So we start our services with a family song. And moving forwards then, our children will have the option to head out to our church hall. At the moment, we literally don't have enough volunteers to look after our children on a Sunday, which is why they stay with us. But if God lays it on your heart for our children, that would be wonderful. Please let me or Dawn know, so that then our children can go out to a space where they can really flourish and grow. But let us stand together as we worship as families, as church together. Dawn. Father Abraham, many sons, many sons and Father Abraham, I am one of them, and so are you. Sit down. Well done. It's great. So we were singing Father Abraham, for you may be aware that today also is a day where we celebrate dads, we celebrate fathers, we celebrate those who are with us, those who aren't, but ultimately it points to our Heavenly Father, God. And at the beginning of our service, we have a little moment where we have a bit of an object lesson, an illustration of what we're going to be looking at for the rest of the service. So Kai. Getting it ready, I guess. Okay, Kai, there's a microphone. So what are we looking at this Sunday as a church?
So this Sunday...
Yep.
Okay, this Sunday we'll be looking at a certain man. So this is the man. But our man is missing some bits. We need lots of love poured into this man.
The kids.
Just... And we want this man to look like, who is it, Mark?
We would like it to be Noah, so we're going to be looking at Noah.
Noah. Right now it doesn't even look like a man. Do you think anyone can kind of help and kind of draw some details to make it look like Noah? If you would like to come, why don't you come grab a pen? Thank you. Round of applause for the children. Wow, look at that. The most amazing representation of Noah I've ever seen. Okay, and the idea is that God chose this one man, blessed this one man, and through one man, do you think you can help me?
Yeah, me.
Through this one man, it wasn't just him who was blessed. It was his whole family.
Can you pull it?
There we go. A whole family.
Yeah, all right. Thank you, children, for the effort. A lot of effort goes into that. And again, we desperately need volunteers to help with the children. We want to be a church that reaches out to families. And actually, that was very theologically accurate, because that unexpected breaking and rending of the families, well, we see that happen later on through the Old Testament. So... I love that. Thank you, children. Thank you, Kai. And thank you, Dawn, as well, for leading us in our family song. As we continue our service, it's so important we bring ourselves before God. So we're coming to a time of confession. And so we know that God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So in a moment of relative silence, let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Thank you, Jesus. And let us pray together as a church. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for your saving grace. Lord, thank you for your forgiveness for each and every one of us, that you forgive our sins as we turn to face you aright. In Jesus' name, amen. Wonderful. And if you're able, please stand with me as we sing our first hymn, Before the Throne of God Above. And that's what we're doing this morning. We're coming before his table, before his throne. Thank you. Let's sing out together, church. Please be seated. Our collect prayer for today, let us pray. God, our Saviour, look on this wounded world. And just in a moment, just draw to mind the brokenness that we recognise to be in the world around us. Look on this wounded world in pity and in power. Lord, hold us fast to your promises of peace, won for us by your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And everybody says, Amen. The Collect Prayer is a prayer that's prayed by Anglicans all over the world, so we join in with that endless prayer. And talking of unity and oneness, our children this week were baking some cookies in the cottage next door. And so we thought this would be a great time for them to share them out. And Kai, cookies, who are they for? I don't know.
They're for the fathers.
So we wanted to really honour and remember those, not just biologically, but those who have been spiritual fathers or mentors So I hand over to you. Thank you, children. And you know, we have food for our tummies, but we also have food for our souls. So let's open our ears to hear and receive God's word.
The reading is from Genesis chapter 7, verses 17 to 19, chapter 8, verses 1 to 5, 18 to 22, and chapter 9, verses 8 to 17. The flood continued for 40 days on the earth. And the waters increased and bore up the ark, and it rose high above the earth. The waters swelled and increased greatly on the earth, and the ark floated on the face of the waters. The waters swelled so mightily on the earth that all the high mountains under the whole heaven were covered. But God remembered Noah and all the wild animals and all the domestic animals that were with him in the ark. And God made a wind blow over the earth, and the waters subsided. The fountains of the deep and the windows of the heavens were closed. The rain from the heavens were restrained. And the waters gradually receded from the earth. At the end of 150 days, the waters had abated. And in the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. The waters continued to abate until the 10th month. In the 10th month, on the first day of the month, the tops of the mountains appeared. So Noah went out with his sons and his wife and his sons' wives, and every animal, every creeping thing, and every bird, everything that moves on the earth, went out of the ark by families. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took of every clean animal and of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelt the pleasing odor, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of humankind, for the inclination of the human heart is evil from youth. Nor will I ever again destroy every living creature as I have done. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, as for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. God said, this is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I'm just going to invite forward our reader for our gospel reading. Thank you, Clive. And just as Clive comes to give us our gospel reading, just allow those words of the story of Noah, that narrative, just to kind of sink in a little bit. Thank you, Clive. Yeah, let's stand. Thank you.
The gospel reading today is from Mark chapter 4, verses 26 to 34. My glory to you, O Lord. It's the parable of the growing seed. He also said, the kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, and then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come. The parable of the mustard seed. He also said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable would we use it for? It is like a mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade. The use of the parables. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. Praise to you, O Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ. Thank you, Clive. Please take a seat. wonderful. Can you hear me? All right, I'm going to be... Are you sure? All right, I'm going to try and speak loudly so that you can all hear me. I'm going to start with a question. How many of you follow St. John Woodley's Facebook page? Just show of hands. Okay, a decent number of us. We have Instagram, we have, you know, YouTube, we have Twitter. Well, before I actually begin, can I please encourage you to follow and engage with our church social media channels? Not only do they cover what's going on at church, but they're also a great way to make our church visible to the community around us. I've talked in recent weeks about making space in the cottage upstairs for youth to come. Now, we don't have many youth, but God has said, you know, dig a well and I'll send the rain. In the same way, we're trying to create a space online. We don't have many members of our community engaging with our church at all, but we're creating that space, hoping that God sends the rain, that God will bring people and draw them to himself. And to this church. And there was a slide of our social media channels, and I'll put it up again after service. But the reason I asked if you follow the church Facebook page is because I happened to take this photo on Monday. It's two photos. There was a brief shower in the afternoon, just after lunch, and this beautiful double rainbow suddenly appeared over this church. Jamie, my youngest son, and I, we ran over to the church to take some photos. And you can see how beautiful the view was just from the office porch. You can see the porch wood. It really was stunning. And rainbows often remind us of the Old Testament story of Noah and the Ark. And it was only when I was having a hot bath that evening, and maybe it's because I was having a hot bath that evening, that I realized it had been exactly 40 days and 40 nights since Kai and I had literally moved to St. John's. And of course, it was 40 days and 40 nights that the rain fell on the earth. So you can see how my brain works, can't you? But given the past 4.5 years, where waters, I would say, have been very rough for us for one reason or another at this church, with all of the changes and chopping, I thought we could actually take a look at this story. And we're going to look at it using the lens of what I call 3 P's, okay? That's people, place, and provision. This is just a way I often use to look at Old Testament texts, okay? It's kind of like a matrix to understand Old Testament stories. And if you notice in our gospel reading, it said that Jesus often spoke in parables, right? But then he explained things to his disciples. We've just heard the story, this creative story of Noah. We've just had a beautiful object lesson, a creative telling of Noah, which Kai gave. This is a time where we open the word and hopefully God by his Spirit will explain to us, teach us what he's trying to say to us as a church. So the first P, let's start with God's people. As we look at the opening words of chapter 8, it says, God remembered Noah. If you only remember one thing from this talk, let it be this. God remembers you. Now, that doesn't mean that God has forgotten you at some point in the past. It means that God knows you and he won't forsake you. Receive that word. Because imagine for a moment how it must have been for Noah. It had already rained for 40 days and 40 nights. And if you look at our passage, it says that after the rain had stopped, it took an additional 150 days for the water to go down. That's an extra 5 months. That's a long time. And if we read on, it says the water doesn't completely dry up until Noah's 601st year. And we know from Genesis 7 that Noah had only just turned 600 when the flood had started. So Noah has been sitting in this boat with all these animals for an entire year. I don't know what kind of year you've had, but I wouldn't have been surprised if Noah at some point would have wondered if God had forgotten about him. I know that's how I can feel at times. But here's the thing, the Bible says God remembered Noah. In fact, if you take the story of Noah, and it was originally on like scrolls, and you laid them out flat in the original language, you'll find that these words, God remembered, fall exactly in the middle of the story. Very interesting, like exactly. In fact, scholars think the story was written around the central point. It's like when I write a song, I start with the chorus and the hook, and write the rest of a song around it. The writer has constructed his text in a way to drive home the importance of this point. God remembers you. Last week, we were in the book of Mark, weren't you? Do you remember I talked about how Mark used literary devices and techniques? Remember a chiasm? Some of you went home and Googled it, because you let me know. This is the writer of this story using literary techniques to tell us something. God remembers you. Even in the midst of the floods of life, and even in the weeks and months, and listen to this, that follow. And sometimes they can be the hardest, like when we've lost someone we love, those weeks and months that follow. This story reminds us that God is faithful to his people. Isn't that wonderful? This is the God who's with us. Okay, second P, God's place. So just follow along with the story. When Noah and his family leave the ark, they're in a new place, a promised land. But again, if I'm to be honest, there are times when I don't feel like I've arrived in that promised land yet. If I'm honest, there are times where I still feel like I'm stuck in the boat, right? Surrounded by water and waiting for God. What do we do? What do we do when we're in that place? Have you ever heard that saying, we're all in the same boat? I think I've said this before. If you look at the ceiling, you'll see that the underside is shaped like, it's meant to be shaped like the bottom of a boat. In fact, the whole section of the church that goes from back wall up to the end is called a nave, navy, which is derived from the Latin word ship. So right now, as God's people, we're all in the same boat together. We haven't got many wild animals, but we're actually, one of the gardeners said there's a hole here where a mouse is getting in, so here we are. We're all in the same boat together. And as God's people here at St. John's, we, all of us, youngest to oldest, are called to be a community. And that sometimes means inhabiting the places of hurt and despair, loving and caring for one another, to mourn with those who mourn and rejoice with those who rejoice. Last Tuesday, I know many of you were there, we had the memorial for Jean. What a wonderful example of God's people drawing together that Tuesday to love and care for one another. I was talking to Rachel. They're not here today, they're visiting a family. She was so deeply moved that this place was full of people who loved them. Now, if we look back at that picture on Facebook, the church almost looks like looks like an ark, doesn't it? Can you see it? Upside down, like a boat from the angle. No matter what place you are in, God is faithful, and as his people, we are called to journey with one another through the floods that come to us. So I want to say this, if you are going through a difficult or uncertain time, hear me, please do not do it on your own. God has made us into one people for a purpose. We have a grief cafe that meets once a month. If you're feeling alone or uncertain, come and join us. On Wednesdays after communion, we have a Bible study, but half of it is also just time to fellowship, to pour tea for one another, to love what, lunch, munch, and a chinwag on Fridays. It is growing, regularly over 20 people, and we're beginning to get diversity in ages as well of people sharing life. Do not journey on your own, okay? And what's significant about this passage is that God says, it's on the screen, come out of the ark, you and your wife, your sons and your sons' wives with you. Now, this is quite interesting. God is not just addressing Noah, is he? But Noah's family. And this is significant because the original promise of deliverance made by God in Genesis 6 was just between God and Noah. Noah was the one identified. Oh, they made a paper airplane out of him already. Noah was the one identified as righteous. No one else. But as we saw Kai and the children, we see through, I haven't got it, they've taken it apart. Use your imaginations. But through one man's obedience, through one man of whom they have a personal relationship with, they are all saved. Can you see how this pattern points forward to Jesus? Because of one human, one man going to the cross, a man who was righteous, we, his family, can all be saved. Noah's family became a new community through him, just as we become a new community. We become a new community. Listen to those words. Through Christ. I am excited about the future of St. John's. I think we should all be excited. I know some of us are feeling like I don't want to allow myself to be excited because it's been a really hard time. Okay? But through the righteousness of one man, a new community, a new creation, a new kingdom was established. And we believe that God is establishing his purpose, his will, his community here. Amen? Amen. Okay, the final P is provision, coming into land. At the very end of chapter 8, we see that God makes a promise. He says, never again will I curse the ground because of humans, even though the inclinations of the heart are evil, and never again will I destroy all the living creatures as I've done. Okay, we're not going to focus here on God's words so much, but I want to look at the verse that immediately precedes it, okay? It says in verse 20 that as soon as Noah was on dry ground, what does he do? He built an altar to the Lord. He builds an altar and he makes a sacrifice upon it. If you're familiar with the story of Adam and Eve, you may recall that after sin and shame entered the world in Genesis 3, God sacrifices an animal. Okay, look at the parallels. So that Adam and Eve could be clothed in righteousness. It actually says that. So he sacrifices an animal and uses the skins to clothe them in righteousness. Well, here in our story, another sacrifice is made. And this is what pleases God. And it is then, after the sacrifice, that God says, never again will I curse the ground. And can you see the threads joining up? This is crucial for us as a church. Because this demonstrates, God's word demonstrates that God's resolve, God's promise and provision of salvation is not based on anything that we do or us behaving perfectly, but that it's based on sacrifice. And notice in all of those texts, it says that a clean animal was used. Only a sacrifice that was righteous is adequate. And just as Noah was the righteous one, through whom his family received salvation, so it is through Christ's righteousness that we might be spared judgment and consequences of sin. That is the good news. And I was speaking to some young people here outside. When I approached them, smoking their spliffs and stuff in our porch, They instantly went to grab their bikes and cycle off. I said, whoa, wait up, you're not in trouble. And they were like, oh, we thought you were going to kick us out. And I said, look, you know, they said, we thought you didn't like us. I'm like, you don't even know me, I don't even know you. And I was trying to explain to them that the church is open for them. All right, I said, look, I'm not going to, you know, front up at what you're doing. You're grown-ups, you can do what you like with your bodies kind of thing. But I invited them into church, and they looked at me kind of quizzically, and then they cycled off, kind of, I could see them musing, like, you can't make this guy out. We thought he was kicking us out. It's not about what we've done. Salvation, forgiveness comes through the love, grace, and mercy and sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. So that's the final P. His provision is based on Christ, whom we draw full assurance from him. I hope those young guys come back and begin to draw assurance from this Jesus they're going to hear about. So in closing, I want us to take a look at that rainbow again. We can't talk about Noah without talking about the rainbow, right? We read in chapter 9 that the sign of God's covenant is delivered in the form of a rainbow. And in the text, it actually says, it doesn't say rainbow, it says bow. Okay, it says, and you can see it, a bow in the clouds, a bow I've seen, a rainbow, but it says a bow. Now, if you look at the original language, the Hebrew term used to describe the rainbow here is the bow, but ready? Of a bow, thank you, Jamie, of a bow and arrow, of a warrior, okay? And in keeping with what we've learned in terms of salvation, what the writer here is painting a picture of God hanging up his war bow on sin and unrighteousness, and he's hanging up that weapon of war that rains down on us. And what's beautiful is, and the original readers of this would have understood this, is that a weapon of war is transformed into a symbol of freedom and delight. And so as we consider the way in which Jesus paid for our freedom from sin, our minds don't turn to a rainbow, but they turn to a cross. Here, we have another weapon of war. Not a bow, but a cross. And although it will always remind us of the sacrifice Jesus made, it also stands as a symbol of the freedom and delight we have in him. I was looking at some pictures when the church was basically built. That cross is still in it. This cross, this symbol, reminds us of the freedom, of the forgiveness, and the hope we have in Jesus. So I am optimistic of what's happening at St. John's because he is here, he is with us. And so, as the people of God, the first P, in this place because of his promise. Let's hold on to these things this morning. Amen. Just allow God's word to take root. There may have been something in that that you know you need to take away and reflect upon and receive. Thank you for your love. Thank you that you remembered Noah, that you remember us in the floods that we are in, God. Thank you that you pull us together as a community where we're not on our own, but we experience your love and forgiveness through one another as well, Lord Jesus. Thank you that you are the head of the church. You have set us free from the wages of sin and death. Lord, that you've made a way for us to the heart of the Father. Amen. So please, if you're able, stand with me as we sing our next song. Let mercy fall on me. can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Dry land, that rock on which we can each stand. So Lord, I pray this morning that each one of us would go away with a deeper assurance of a knowledge of your love in our lives, God. Thank you. Thank you, God. If we could just have the words of a creed just up on the screen, we'll declare our belief, our faith. So as one family in this boat, so to speak, we say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made. Of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven and was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. I'm just going to invite forward whoever's going to be bringing us and leading us in our intercessions now. Thank you.
In Psalm 73, we read, "My heart and my flesh may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." Father God, thank you for knowing us. You made us and you love us. And today we bring before you those who don't know this yet. We are grateful for the way you have designed family life and the specific roles you have given to parents, and pray for fathers and fatherhood across our land. Thank you for our earthly fathers and for the role they have played in our lives. We pray for those fathers who are unable, for whatever reason, to be with their families today. Also, remembering those who are bereft of fathers. We lift to you those who care for loved ones and ask for the necessary help and provision for their needs. We think of those who are in abusive relationships and pray for their safety, especially for the children suffering in such situations. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the continuing crises in Ukraine and in Gaza, and pray for an end to the bloodshed. For the humanitarian crisis in the Democratic Republic of Congo and other countries where there is famine, so much hunger and malnutrition. Heavenly Father, would you raise up world rulers of authority who are active and effective in peacemaking, that the measured voices of diplomacy may constrain violence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we bring before you our own country with the forthcoming elections. Will you raise up people of substance, character, and faith to influence the destination of our nation for your glory? We remember before you the deprived areas of our nation where crime is rife. We think of the amount of knife crime, drugs, and shoplifting that is rampant in such areas, and pray you will send witnesses of your love into these dark places, that people will find the hope that comes from you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Father, we bring to you those who are unwell in body, mind, or spirit, and pray your healing touch for them. And for those who grieve the loss of a loved one, may they know your presence and comfort in their sorrow. Praying especially for Marion, Mick, and Wendy. Gracious Father, increase our understanding. Help us to learn how to put your teachings into practice. Help us to listen with our hearts, purify our motives, and lead us into a greater spiritual maturity for your praise and glory. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you so much for leading us together in those prayers. God will speak his peace to his people, to those who turn to him in their hearts. And so the peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's take some time to turn and share the peace with one another. Peace be with you. Children. I love each week how the children bring the gifts, in some ways, as an example of us bringing ourselves before the Lord's table to receive, like children, from Him. Thank you, God. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you've created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. And by the power of the Holy Spirit. He took flesh as your Son, born of a blessed virgin. He lived on earth and went out among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. And so he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. And therefore, with angels and archangels and with the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name here in Woodley, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of your Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and he gave you thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. I'm just going to interject that word remembrance. And then in our story of Noah, the point of that sacrifice made so that each one of us could be clothed in righteousness. Great is a mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his sacrifice made once and for all for the sins of the world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup. We thank you for counting us worthy to stand as we're standing now in your presence. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather us one in your kingdom, all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. And so, together in one voice, let us pray the prayer our Saviour taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. Wonderful. So please do come forward. If you'd like a blessing, just leave your hands down. I'll happily pray with you. You know, it's always that lovely peace that comes after communion. And to stretch it a bit far, but again, I was thinking of that story of Noah after those storms, entering into that peace, entering into that rest, entering into that promise of God as a family together. Let us say our prayer after communion. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. All right, before our closing hymn and final prayer and blessing, just a couple of notices. Again, if you would like to join us in growing a team so we can do more children's work, please contact me after the service. Any other notices? Anybody have a notice they want to share? No? All right then. Well, if you're able, please stand with me as we go out in praise. Thank you. And so the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you forevermore. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.